Good afternoon, everyone. I'm a clinician, and I'd like to have a hand show. Can I see how many clinicians and how many senior nurses are in this room? Put your hands up, please. Okay. So, Glenn, there's the message. What we need is far greater clinical engagement in this project, because I think clinical engagement is the key. And I'll try and show you now how some of the information that we've used at Derby it has helped. Basically, if you look, to go back to what Pat said at the beginning, clinical effectiveness in terms of what we do as surgeons, what we do as carers, is to work out what intervention does more good than harm. And basically, we are some way down this path by using our tracking systems. We are a long way away from where we want to be, because we want to get to the point that we're looking at complications and we're looking at outcomes as well as everything else I'm going to show you. But essentially, I want you to just consider what we do in our lives. Now, this was my last skiing holiday, all right? And so you'll see the skis are barcoded, the groceries are barcoded, the rental car is barcoded, and the Arc'teryx dealer is also selling me a barcoded product. And yes, look at the barcode in the middle at the top. That's Denver International Airport Gents Toilet, all right? And so I use the facility, I can scan the barcode, I can send them a message on how their facility has served me well. And just to give you another example, this is my last channel crossing, and if you go on the shuttle, has anyone been on the shuttle recently? Everything is barcoded. I drive to the terminal, it's number plate recognition, that is printed out, and that is that, because all my data is on that barcode. All my passport details, everything is on that barcode. And you know, I put that in, the one on the top left, to just show you how compliance is achieved in other areas. This is a friend of mine who has a shop selling equestrian products. And you see, he puts a barcode on, and then he has to put a little reminder on for his staff, please scan me, all right? Now, we haven't quite had to do that at Derby, but we've been working hard. So in retail, in John Lewis, in Tesco, in some of the other big retailers, everything is based on point of use and what the customer buys. So why can't we use this for the patient? Well, we have, and we do. And it's part of what we do now at Derby. It is what we do. It's embedded in the process. So there's the name band. There's the barcode. And so everything we use is attributed to that particular patient and that particular barcode. So why is it important? Well, when the horse meat scandal came about, the speed with which the product was traced was amazing. However, as Glenn said earlier, 30,000 women still don't know whether they've got a product that's in their body that's defective. And I think that is completely and utterly unacceptable. And those of you that have listened to the news this morning, there's a big review on cosmetic surgery going ahead. This is going to help. This is going to help if we use it. So basically, what we do is everything is scanned, absolutely everything. The patient, the staff, and I mean every HCA that's in theatre, we scan them. If the surgeon is not in theatre, he doesn't get scanned. So I know as clinical director how many lists these guys have turned up for. I know how many cases they've done. And so it makes my job a hell of a lot easier as clinical director. We're looking at all loan sets, and we are looking at the detail, the fine detail. And we're doing it because we have staff that are prepared to use a relatively simple technique to record information. How do we get clinical engagement and how do we start? Well, it was a real culture change that we had to try and bring about. And the first thing that we identified is that we would start in a compliant area. And I happen to be a head and neck surgeon, and we have a really compliant group within head and neck. They wanted this to work. And what's more, we have a project team, Kevin, James, Chris, and others, that are, they are real people. They're not virtual directors of finance and performance. They are real people. And so they came down and they sold this message to us from the outset. And so if anybody in my theatre suite sees Kevin Downs walking through or James Main, They know who they are. Now, that's a revolution in the NHS, because people like Kevin and people like Kevin's team were in the management floor and didn't come near us. But we do this and do it all together. But we sold it to them on the basis that we were looking at patient safety, that we were looking at traceability. We were actually identifying how much income these surgeons were actually generating for the trust. We were able to tell you that our average orthopedic surgeon earns about $720,000 for the trust, but we've got one or two little stars that earn $1.3 million for the trust. Hitherto, we didn't have the information. What's more, when it's things like joint registers, we can update external records quickly. And in terms of where we were failing, things like comorbidity, what we're able to do now is to record the comorbidities, so get the correct tariff for what we're doing, and to help people like our medical director understand our Dr. Foster data. So if we've got high death rates, well, it's perhaps not surprising if we're treating very complicated cases. And what we've done is we've simplified the process because, you, as Kevin said, it sits in the palm of your hand. But what I want you to focus on is, if you look, the OPCS codes are already loaded onto the device. So we haven't got nurses running around looking for OPCS codes. They scroll down, they hit it with a cursor, and it's tracked. And if you look at the effect that this had on our coding, if you look at the average coding depth that we had in Derby, you can see it's the red line. You can see that we weren't particularly good at what we were doing. And that means that we weren't getting the income for what we were actually doing within the trust. How do I know? Well, Kevin's told me that by the end of December 13, we had 840,000 pounds worth of procedures that weren't coded. We lost that income. No trust can afford to lose income at that level. And what we've done is that we've used our GS1 license. So in areas such as mine, you'll see the top barcode, microsurgical graft to facial nerve. We've got our own designated GS1 barcode for procedures that we've developed within the trust. This is how the coders receive the HTRAC data. So they still, they're lovely people and they still want to go through the notes and they still want to check everything, but they actually get the procedure like this. So we have the diagnosis codes of the comorbidities, and then as you can see with this patient, from November 14 to February 15, we've got the OPCS codes recorded so that they can cross-reference that to the notes to make sure that we're generating the correct amount of income. And here's the comorbidities chart that we use, and we can scan in the comorbidities as you can see. So it's quick, it's efficient, and we're recording all the relevant areas that we need to within the data capture. And this is what happened. Now, look at the end of quarter four, 13-14, and quarter one, 14-15. This was for general surgery, not for orthopedics. And you can see that when we introduced the system, there was an immediate blip, an immediate improvement in where we were. But that isn't the only change, because we've looked at what we've done, because we've learned from the numbers. And we've addressed some of our operational practice and some of the false economies that we were using. This is a plating system used in head and neck reconstruction. And what we were doing is every screw on that system was being reautoclaved and reautoclaved and reautoclaved. And we were paying a fee to Synergy based on the number of items on that particular tray, including the screws. We had problems in that when we were working out of hours, we had untrained staff putting screws in the wrong site, the wrong sizes, the wrong dimensions, and it was all of a problem. So we've done away with all that because we've learned from our tracking system. So what we now do is this. We have single screws, as you see on the left, or we have triple packs, as you see on the right. Every one of them is barcoded, but the important thing is they're all pre-sterilized. What does it cost us? An additional 50p per pack. But we only scan what we use and we only open what we need. And so the deal is, the surgeon says, I want another three screws. The pack is opened, is scanned, then it's opened. So we track everything as we use it, even down to the single screw. Here's another one, because what was happening here was we were buying a suction catheter, cutting it up into four pieces, sending it off to Synergy, getting it autoclaved, and it was coming back, and it was costing us five times as much. So what do we now do? We've actually got it already cut up in advance, and it comes pre-sterilized. And this is something we didn't know we were doing until we started to track and scan. Another example, do you use a single plate that's 20 holes long, or do you use four separately packed plates that are five holes long? Well, I can tell you, the data's shown us open one big one because it's a hell of a lot cheaper. And here another one, this is just the difference between buying a plate that's bent and a plate that's straight. Now, you don't have to bend the plate in the theater because we scan the patients so we can bend them in the laboratory before theater to save time. But what we have discovered is that if we use a pre-bent plate from a manufacturer for a jaw, it adds another £240 for the privilege of just having a plate that's bent that we then have to bend again in theater. So we've learned an awful lot by drilling down into the data. And we can look at clinical variation. And for me as a clinical director, it's opened up a whole new experience. And perhaps, Owen, a can of worms, right? Just look at this, ladies and gentlemen. Just look at this. Now, this was a chart that I went to James Main yesterday afternoon. I said, James, I'm going to give you two OPCS codes, and I'm going to give you six clinicians' names. And I want you to give me a printout of their consumables costs and the average theatre time. Okay. If you look at the bottom line, the case takes 90 minutes on average, and the consumable costs are on average £188. Now, he happens to be the most experienced surgeon in the trust doing this procedure. Okay, so let's look at the top end of the spectrum. Only one case, I accept. But that's a case that was done out of hours, and it was done under the care and the supervision of a consultant by a registrar. So that case used £285 of the consumables and took 181 minutes. The one next to that is, again, the least experienced surgeon in the trust in terms of who came, how long they've been doing it, who's just arrived. And for me, that gives me really interesting data. It doesn't tell me anything about outcome yet or complications yet, but it will. But what it does tell me is that we really need to look at how we do things and who does these things. Because I think it's really important that a patient is on and off the table as quickly as possible. And clearly, experience seems to count for something. And where do we go? Well, we have reports in HRG groupings, as you can see here, that are really very busy. But then what we like to try and do is to look at procedure codes. We look at individual procedure codes to see how much cost they're attracting. And then what we do is that we actually look at the procedure codes and we compare them consultant to consultant, because that is also important. And what I'd like you to do on the lower part of the image is look at the number of staff. Now, I'm the one on the bottom line. And three up, there is a colleague of mine. Now, you'll notice that I managed to get through the procedure in 40 minutes, and he is taking 61 minutes. But I've got two more staff in my theater. So Kevin has already said to me, now, Keith, should we not be thinking about putting another two HCAs into his theater, and we can get another case on the list? So this is not about procurement for me. This is about much more than procurement. This is about us really understanding what we do and the data informing us of what we're doing. And I just want to give you one final example. This was a serious untoward incident. that occurred in our trust. And you will notice that I'll flick through them. I'll come back to that, that it's a very busy report. Look at the bottom line, ladies and gentlemen. Is it 16,000? No, it's £18,742, okay? But there was a complication. And the complication related to the patient suffering a nerve injury during the procedure. So I was asked to look at it as clinical director with colleagues, and we had some independent anaesthetists because the anaesthetist and the surgeon were at odds about how this arose. Well, one of the things that I was aware of was that in terms of clinical standards, one of the key issues is the surgeon should correctly have checked what he was doing by using a nerve stimulator to identify the area in which he was working and the nerves in that area. So what did I do? We went through the report, and nowhere in that £18,000 report did I identify that instrument. So it's all a bit game, set, and match, because accepted clinical practice is that a surgeon should correctly check what he's doing. And my stock control process, that's how it started out, which has grown into this huge project for us at Derby, is doing a hell of a lot more than stock control. It's informing, it's enlightening, and it's embracing lots of our staff, including clinicians. And it may look a bit busy, but can you believe it? My surgeons want to see how much they're spending. They're competitive animals. They like to see where they are in terms of the team. And this project that we're under, that we're involved in, has really helped in that regard. And we have a very enthusiastic group at Derby that believe in what we're doing. And I would urge all of you that can influence clinicians elsewhere in the UK within the NHS is to get involved with this project. Thank you very much for your attention.